It's a difficult morning, it's very early in the morning, but also difficult days. And the issue, the topic, the relations between the parties, complete lack of trust. Udi mentioned in his opening what the chief of staff said yesterday. He said that the terror in Judea and Samaria is going to remain with us for many years to come. And there's a big conflict. And the poll that was presented yesterday, the survey, Udi mentioned it, but I want to mention another point. 60% of support in the two-state solution were in the survey among the Israeli people. David Grossman spoke almost only on what is happening inward, the feeling of persecution and victimization that we adopted, a country that is being pushed to the corner. The PM, after what Ambassador Shapiro said yesterday, issued all sorts of announcements all night that also took a lot of volume in the social networks. We are here in order to try to clarify with our distinguished guests what is right to do so that everything will be better for all of us. Even if we renew the negotiations, I think there's no controversy that the probability to come to a permanent agreement to put an end to the conflict is very low. But in the middle, between the situation we're in at the moment and a permanent agreement, there are a lot of opportunities, and that's what we'd like to talk about today. I think that each of them actually compels us at least to renew some sort of a political process. We had to talk about a regional dialogue based on the common denominator that grows between us and Egypt and Jordan and the Gulf countries. We have to talk about direct negotiations between Israelis and Palestinians through agreements and interim agreements. And also we have to talk about independent steps that will determine the border between the two nations, and all that in order to have a reality of two nation states. Yesterday, all day, and I think there was not one of the speakers who didn't mention it, that among all the threats, there are quite a few opportunities as well that we have to seize in order to get out of this mess. And we have the quartet to help us do it. Israel, from our perspective as Israelis, cannot continue to have battles all the time. We cannot delude ourselves that the conflict can be managed, that we are managing it without having some sort of a hope to come to an agreement. The question is if two states for two peoples is still a desired situation for Israel, and I think that the answer is clear. Obviously, yes, because that ensures a democratic state to the Jewish people, safe state that separated from the Palestinians in all the channels that we know about. And it's not clear why in this issue, where is the daring, the creativity, and the courage that typify us as Israelis in so many other aspects? For many years, too many, there was no Israeli initiative. Israel is dragged, it reacts, it's surprised, and it does not initiate. This, I think, we have to change before we're going to be imposed with the arrangements that will not be good for us. And before we go over to the extremism and the radicalism that are happening here in Israel. Our guests in this session, each of them had very important positions in the political process recently. Moshe Arendt, I will introduce when he arrives. Hiba Husseini
chairs the legal committee to final status negotiations. She has served as legal advisor to the peace negotiations since 1994 and is a member of several working groups, namely trade and economic relations, as well as the status of Jerusalem. Welcome, Hiba. David Makovsky is the director of the project on the Middle East peace process at the Washington Institute. He was recently an advisor to Secretary of State John Kerry in the last round of negotiations. His maps on alternative territorial solutions to the conflict were reprinted by the New York Times. Yossi Beilin.
Dr. Yossi Beilin, the one who wrote the Abu Mazen Beilin document. He was the Minister of Finance. He was the Deputy Foreign Minister. I will start with you, David Makovsky. We're turning now into Hebrew translation. אתה היית בראש הצוות של המזכיר קרי. אתה יכול להרחיב קצת על התפקיד של ארצות הברית בעתיד. בוקר טוב לכולם. גיל, לכבוד רב לי להיות כאן עם פאנל כל כך מכובד וקהל כזה מכובד. אני נתבקשתי להצטרף גם לעמיתי ג'ון אלן, שהוא ממש איקון אמריקאי, הוא היה חלק מן הצוות, ואנחנו ניסינו. אתם צריכים להבין שהיו שלושה מאמצים אמריקניים מאז 2000 לפתור את כל הבעיות. היה קמפ דיוויד, וגיל, אתה בעצמך היית שם הרי, יחד עם אהוד ברק ועם קלינטון ויאסר ערפאת. היה תהליך אנאפוליס. והדבר השלישי היה מאמץ של קרי, שאני חושב 9 חודשים של מסע ומתן מאוד מאוד אינטנסיבי, כדי לראות אם אנחנו יכולים להגיע לאיזושהי עסקה בתוך אמונה שאנחנו יכולים לפרוץ את אותם נושאים, ואז אנחנו נוכל לעסוק בכל אותם הפרטים. ואתם יודעים שיש הרבה מאוד פרטים בנושאים האלה, אבל אני הייתי אומרת שהחמש מתוך החמישה דברים העיקריים, אני ראיתי פריצת דרך, אני יכולתי לחזות, וזה דבר שהוא מפורסם ברבים, אני לא על העניין של השטחים, אני לא יכול עכשיו להיכנס לכל העניין של עמדת ישראל, הפליטים וכן הלאה, אבל שלושת הנושאים האחרים, הייתי אומר שאנחנו ניסינו, אנחנו יכולים ללכת בדרך הראשית, בדרך הצדדית, דרך החלון, דרך הערובה. אנחנו לא רוצים להגיד שאין יצירתיות אמריקאית בנושא הזה, אבל אותם שלושה נושאים, ועמוס דיבר על כך אמש, אנחנו דיברנו על ירושלים, ההכרה ההדדית, והדבר השלישי, סידורי הביטחון. אם אתם קוראים את הספרות, גילי, גם הספר שלך ויוסי ביילין, כולם כתבו על 2000, סידורי הביטחון היו צריכים להיות הדבר הקל ביותר, אבל הרבה מאוד מים כבר זרמו בירדן מאז אותה תקופה, ואז הייתה אינתיפאדה השנייה ואביב ערבי והתמוטטות של הרבה מאוד מדינות ערביות, ואני מצדיע לג'נרל אלן על המאמצים שלו, אבל אנשים אומרים, טוב, הפלסטינים לא רוצים שלום. אני לא חושב שזה הוגן, כל אחד רוצה הסכם, אבל לפי התנאים שלו. והשאלה היא על אותם שלושה נושאים, האם יש איזושהי פשרה הולמת, ואני חושב שהמכון למחקרי ביטחון יכול בהחלט להועיל בדבר הזה. המזכיר קרי עבד ללא לאות, ואני חושב שההיסטוריה תהיה הרבה יותר חיובית לגבי קרי מאשר העיתונות. אני חושב שהוא באמת עשה מאמצים ניכרים, אבל אין כל ספק. השאלה היא מה אנחנו עושים עכשיו. מבחינת אמריקה, אנחנו מדברים על המטריצה, והמטריצה נראית לא טוב. וחוסר ההתקדמות, יש לו בהחלט השלכות. ראינו מה שקורה בצד הישראלי, אני לא חושב שאני צריך להבהיר את הדברים לכם. ראיתם את ההתקשחות בצד הפלסטיני, הסקר של שיקקי. כל המטריצות, המפתח, הכל הולך בכיוון הפוך. יש היום תמיכה באלימות, לא תומכים בפתרון שתי המדינות, לא חושבים שמשהו יכול להיות קורות בחמש השנים הבאות. הדברים הולכים אחורה במקום קדימה. אז רק להגיד שאפשר להכניס את כל העניין לתוך הפריזר ולחכות 20 שנה ולראות מה יקרה, אני חושב שזו טעות גדולה. אנחנו לא יודעים אם הרשות בכלל תהיה שם, אנחנו לא יודעים בכלל אם תהיה תמיכה סידורי ביטחון, ואם אכפת לכם מבחינת ישראל, הרי אם אנחנו רוצים להיות מדינה יהודית, הרי הסטטוס קוו הוא דבר רע, זה אמר ראש הממשלה, לא אני. ואחרת אנחנו מגיעים למדינת שני דו-לאומית. והשאלה, מה אנחנו צריכים לעשות כדי להתקדם, מה קורה מבחינה אזורית, מבחינה מקומית, מבחינת בינלאומית. אמרנו, כן, צריך לעשות כל מיני החלטות, האם ארה״ב יכולה לקדם את הדברים, ואולי אחרי הבחירות בנובמבר יהיו הרבה מאוד שינויים בארה״ב, בין הבחירות בארה״ב והנשיא שיתחלף, אולי יקרו דברים, אבל יש גם סיכון. יכול להיות שזה יהיה מגנט, או שזה יהיה משהו שידחה. אולי זה יביא את הקהילות לשבת יחדיו עליו, אבל יכול להיות שיהיה חמש, עשר שנים, ומי יודע מה יקרה עד אז. יכול להיות שזה יהיה חיובי, אבל הצד השלילי יכול להיות שזה דווקא יהיה בסיס לקונפליקט קשה יותר, ואנשים לא ירצו לשבת. הרעיון השני הוא מעין ועידה אזורית כלשהי, שאולי תהיה פופולרית כאן בישראל, אבל אני חושב שהעולם ייתקע באותם נושאים עצמם, והערבים לא ייתנו כיסוי פוליטי, ולכן אי אפשר למצוא פתרונות לאותם שלושה נושאים, ונהיה תקועים באותו מצב שאנחנו היום. הדבר השלישי שאמר גילי, הוא שלפחות צריך להתחיל לעשות הפרדה בין שני העמים. נכון, קודם שתהיה כמובן יהיה קשר כלכלי, אבל מבחינה אידיאולוגית, מבחינת הביטחונית, אפשר לעשות את הדבר הזה בשלבים. אני חושב שאלה הן אופציות שכולן פתוחות, אולי לממשל חדש בארצות הברית, אני יודע, אני לא רוצה פה לקחת יותר מדי זמן, אבל אלה הם דבריי.
Welcome, משה ארנס. I'd just like to mention that among the many roles that you fulfilled, you were foreign minister and ambassador in Washington, and a few years ago you wrote that Obama's pursuit for the two-state solution is like chasing a rainbow. And I'd like to ask you, if the two-state solution, can you hear me? What I'm asking is the two-state solution a bad solution? The two-state, do you think it is a bad solution? I'm not sure I understand your question. What is the question? Is the two-state solution that you called chasing the rainbow, is it today too a bad solution in your eyes? I currently do not see any possibility of reaching that solution, if you call that the solution, because ultimately we're talking about an effort to reach a settlement with the Palestinians and to reach an agreement that would end the conflict between Israel and the Palestinians. And I do not see the party on the Palestinian side that is capable of doing so. The Palestinians today, Abu Mazen, the Palestinian Authority, and then Hamas, and the Salafists in addition to Hamas, the Palestinians in the refugee camps, especially in Lebanon and Syria too, and in Jordan, the Palestinians in Jordan, I do not, and I don't think I'm the only one, I don't see Abu Mazen being able or having the authority or ability to reach a settlement that will put an end to the conflict between Israel and the Palestinians. And if we are trying to find the reason why no negotiations are being held, that he's not coming to the negotiations, but is rather choosing the international track to go to the UN, to go to the countries of the world, and not to hold negotiations directly with us. I think the main reason is that he himself knows that he doesn't have the authority to commit and to implement commitments, and we can see the matter of the two states among the Palestinians as connected to Abu Mazen, an agreement with Abu Mazen. I don't think that's on the horizon at this point in time. And this may perhaps be beyond the horizon if we look at the entire Middle East and the chaos that is now characteristic of the Middle East, Syria and Iraq and ISIS and all the various parties that are involved and what's going on in Syria. It's difficult for me to see a development that will stabilize the situation among the Palestinians. I don't see a Palestinian like Arafat, who had the authority and the ability to hold negotiations and to conclude negotiations and implement the agreements, that there would be trust on the Israeli side, that that partner is someone you can seal a deal with. That no longer exists on the Palestinian side, and therefore the question of whether it's possible to reach an agreement with Abu Mazen is an academic question that has no practical applications on the ground. And if we look in the longer term and ask ourselves, will in the longer range, can we imagine seeing another state alongside Israel and another Palestinian state? I see only two options. One is in the context of Jordan, if it would be willing to accept representation of all the Palestinians, those in Jordan and those in Judea and Samaria, and perhaps those who are in Gaza. That doesn't appear on the to be feasible right now, because the regime in Jordan views that as a danger to its very regime. And we also do not wish to endanger the regime in Jordan. We have security cooperation with Jordan. We don't want to endanger it. We wouldn't want to see chaos or anarchy or some kind of uprising there that could danger that cooperation. And another option that appears fantastic right now, and that's a Palestinian state that would be happy to accept the presence of the Jewish population in Judea and Samaria, that it would view that population as an asset that could contribute to the state, like in enlightened states in the world that want to accept immigrants, want to accept a population that can contribute to the economy. That appears totally fantastic at this time, not feasible among Abu Mazen, his people, and Hamas and Abu Mazen and his people. They want to see a country that is free of all Jews. Thank you. Hubert Avis. אני אעבור ישירות אלייך על שתי סוגיות. האם אנחנו מדברים? האם אנחנו מדברים על עזה תחת חמאס והגדה המערבית וישראל כמובן? והשאלה השנייה מתייחסת להערה האחרונה של מר ארנס. מיעוט יהודי קיים בתוך מדינה פלסטינאית אחרי שמדינה כזאת תקום. תודה רבה גלעד, תודה שהזמנתם אותי, טוב להיות כאן בין עמיתים וחברים. אנחנו עוברים תקופה מאוד קשה עם אתגרים מאוד מורכבים, אין ספק בכך. מנקודת מבט פלסטינית אינני רואה בכל רמה מצב שבו יהיו שלוש מדינות מבחינת בחירה, מבחינת שאנחנו נקבל החלטה אסטרטגית לקיים מדינה בעזה, מדינה בגדה המערבית, משום שמבחינתנו זה מוציא את מזרח ירושלים מן הכלל, ולקבל החלטה שזאת הדרך שבה אנחנו הולכים ללכת מבחינה לאומית אחרי כל כך הרבה שנים של השאיפות שלנו למדינה עצמאית מאוחדת, כמובן בין עזה לבין הגדה המערבית, כולל שכוללת את מזרח ירושלים, זה לא נראה לי אפשרי. לגבי השאלה השנייה, לגבי קיומו של מיעוט יהודי בתוך מדינה פלסטינאית, נראה לי שבתוך הרובריקה של החלפות או חילופי אדמות היו דיונים ומושבים פרטיים ומפגשים, והבנו שזה מאוד קשה בשביל ישראל להסיר, להוציא כל כך הרבה מתנחלים ולפרק התנחלויות, זה כל כך קשה. אז הרעיון של חילופי טריטוריה הוכנס, וגם הרעיון של מיעוט יהודי קטן החי במדינת פלסטין עם אזרחות פלסטינית, אבל תוך כך שהם נשארים יהודים, האם זה אפשרי? אפשר לדון על זה. בטווח הקצר, אם היינו חושבים על זה היום, זה נשמע מטורף, אני מבינה את זה. אבל אם היו חושבים על גישה רציונלית לטווח ארוך, סבירה, כדי למצוא דרך לשים קץ לסכסוך ולמצוא פשרה, ההצעה הזאת הועלתה והיא נחשבה לאפשרות. יוסי ביילן, you have spoken recently about a confederation, and that remains a kind of slogan that is not detailed enough and not clear enough to the public, so I would be happy to hear a bit more about that idea. A confederation is an idea that I thought about more than 20 years ago as a later stage for the two-state solution. I thought that at the first stage, let's separate, because that's the most important thing, and at the second stage, we'll talk about cooperation because of the unique nature of the situation. What am I talking about? We're talking about a very small piece of land. The border in Western Land of Israel is an artificial one. It's not rivers or mountains or anything of that nature. The need to cooperate in planning, in dealing with water, agriculture, agricultural diseases, and things of that nature, and many, many others, is so great that the separation is to a very, very great extent artificial. So I said to myself, we should have the two-state solution, and then on top of it would come the solution of a confederation between two sovereign independent states. They would not have a joint parliament or government or joint delegation in the UN, but they would decide amongst themselves which areas they want to collaborate on, from water, which is kind of self-evident, to many other subjects that we discussed over the years. What happened to me, personally, I admit, is in recent years, I see an increasing difficulty mainly in two areas. One area is that of the settlements, the effort on the part of the right to create a very large number of settlements and scatter them deliberately to prevent a two-state solution. That creates a situation where the evacuation of settlements becomes increasingly difficult. Not impossible as I see it, but very difficult. And no matter who the prime minister is in Israel, that will be viewed as the central issue, because that is a confrontation with his own citizens in increasing numbers. And the second is the defense matter, the security matter. We discussed all the years the demilitarization of the Palestinian state, and the Palestinians said in general terms, okay, there's an argument between demilitarization and non-militarization, but in general terms the Palestinians said yes, and we spoke about it a great deal, and there were some very interesting discussions regarding their approach, why it's good for them that they have a demilitarized state. But when facing new challenges such as ISIS and so on, imagine that tomorrow the vision of the peace camp is realized and there are two states for two nations and there is a demilitarized Palestinian state, and it is, there are no tanks, there are planes. What happens then vis-a-vis ISIS? ISIS is looking for weak points. That would be their first weak point, a vulnerability. What would we do? We, the people who initiated Oslo and the settlements, the people who were always looking for the solutions, because they don't believe that we can exist as a state with a Jewish minority and a Palestinian majority. We can't have a Zionist state. These people have to provide answers all the time.
And that's why I think that in the context of a confederation,
we could leave the settlers who wish to do so. I don't believe it would be their majority, but those who wish to do so as Israeli citizens, not only as Jewish people, but as Israeli citizens who are residents of Palestine. Something symmetrical could be given to Palestinians who are citizens of the Palestinian states who wish to be residents of the state of Israel based on our sovereign decision. But no less important is the security issue. If there is a confederation, we could reach an arrangement where there is a joint security system where the IDF would be dominant and would defend the outer perimeter. And many other things. I personally am occupied now with various issues related to the confederation. As you said, that's a headline, but there are many, many details involved. And there is no Another thing that's important is there are no confederations in the world. Those countries that call themselves confederations, such as Switzerland and Canada, they are not confederations based on the divisions of political science. And those countries that don't call themselves confederation, we have the European Union, it is a confederation, in my opinion. It is an example of a confederation that could exist in our region. And if I may say another word about the long term and the short term, I think that the greatest mistake of Secretary of State Kerry was that he went for a final status solution with full force in 9 months. There was not a single article that I read which said, you know, that it has a pretty good chance. And just as he did a wonderful job, in my opinion, on the matter of the agreement with Iran, and Wendy Sherman is here, and if not for her, there would not have been the agreement. I think that he made a very serious mistake, very, very serious, on our issue with that nine-month time frame. He was banging his head against the wall, and he showed once again that low expectations do not prevent deep frustrations or violence. And he should have, in my opinion, gone for the thing that the Americans proposed, the quartet proposed, the Israelis and the Palestinians accepted, the United States Security Council recommended it, and that is the, I didn't like it, and that is the roadmap, and that is a Palestinian map with temporary borders. It could be done today, too, with Abu Mazen, although I agree with your criticism of Abu Mazen. I'm the last person to glorify him. But a Palestinian state in provisional borders with Abu Mazen's demand to fulfill that because he doesn't accept it at face value, he says, give me a vision. He can get a vision. And if we resolve the problem of the Palestinian state, which for us as Zionists is a central issue, not because of the Palestinians, but because of the border, we need a border of one kind or another, unilateral. If we have no choice, then it'll be unilateral. In a few years' time, it'll happen in any case. We need to prefer an agreement, and in the short term, the matter of Gaza, we can have provisional borders, and at the later stage, a confederation could facilitate the implementation of a final status agreement.
In light of the criticism on the way
על הדרך שבה מזכיר קרי אמר שהמטרה העיקרית של תשעת החודשים היא כזאת, איך הייתם מתבוננים בדבר הזה בדיעבד? ומדוע שארצות הברית תעמיד את הפרמטרים כעוגן, אולי למשא ומתן עתידי, או אולי מועצת הביטחון של האו"ם, להניח את הדברים על השולחן ולדון במקום שירדן או צרפת או ניו זילנד יזמו את השולחן.
you know, your question. I mean, look, I think you're hearing from these three of the four of us our doubts that there can be a two-state solution in one go. You know, Yossi, Moshe, and myself have mentioned, you know, the issue of security in the short term, and that it's more, I think, a longer-term aspiration, perhaps, that you can solve all the problems. But in the Middle East, when it's all or nothing, it tends to be nothing. And I think that is, you know, that's a question. I think with Secretary Kerry, and he made the decision, you know, before Martin Indyk came on board, before I came on board, and he said both leaders say they want a two-state solution, and the window was closing on that two states. And that was the decision he made, believing that, again, and I think with some, you know, correctness, that stagnation leads to radicalization. I think when I joined the team, I was pleasantly surprised, and I think the public here would be pleasantly surprised. But like I said, on two of the five issues, the leaders, I saw the way for them to bridge their differences. The thesis that the secretary was trying to explore was, if America puts 9 months into this, finally we will know that with enough American energy and focus, we will test the proposition that the problem is whether the U.S. is willing to put that kind of resources in it. I think we have. I think we now know what the differences are more than before. You know, it's easy for me in retrospect to say, I would have done it differently. That's easy. But, I have to deal with the pragmatic reality. We are where we are. And the question for me now is where do we, you know, go from here? Your point about you released the framework, I think, is a fair question. But I think it's complex. First of all, we made a commitment to these parties to confidentiality. America takes that commitment seriously to the leaders. We don't violate that, you know, with equanimity. We don't see any leaked versions that have come out in the newspapers or anything like that. Point two, I think you have an issue that there were moments, and I talked to some of my colleagues before I appeared here. I thought I might get asked that. There were moments where there was more than one draft in order to elicit a response, and then the question is, what draft do you release? And the third point is, the political context has changed pretty radically, and the compromises that will be made might be less understood today than more understood. I do believe that if we get back to these issues, that will be the starting point. Look, I'm not saying, you know, nobody made mistakes here. I think everyone made mistakes in the Kerry period. I think on the Israel side, you know, I tracked on the settlements thing. Yes, most of the settlement tenders were within, we call the blocks, but much of the planning was outside the blocks, and that is something that was seen by the Palestinian side as bad faith. I think on the Palestinian side, the biggest mistake was that they didn't get back to our president on March 17, 2014, which I think will go down in history as a key moment when we wanted a response, and they didn't get back to us. And I think with respect, you know, the United States did a lot of great things. If I had to be very self-reflective about our mistake was was not calling them on that and not just saying they're too weak to criticize. Because if you want a deal, everybody has to be accountable. And if you don't hold each side accountable, then you can't make a deal with that person. So I'm not saying mistakes weren't made. And I do want to say one thing in the U.S.-Israel context, because there were some attacks on Dan Shapiro. I heard this speech.
דן שפירו, אני שמעתי את דבריו. ממה ששמעתי לא היה שום דבר שונה ממה שאומרים אנשי הממשל הרשמיים. אני אומר שאופן אישי, דן, אין מישהו שלא עובד יומם ולילה כדי לקרב בין ישראל וארצות הברית. דן שפירו הוא האדם, ראיתי איך הוא פועל, ואני מקווה שההקשר הזה ייראה בצורה יותר רחבה, ושלא יהיה פה איזשהו דבר אישי, מפני שהוא באמת עובד מדינה יוצא מן הכלל, והוא נכס לארצות הברית, גם וגם לעניין השלום ולעניין הקשר בין ישראל וזה. The complexity of all this issue that we're dealing with is growing when we're looking at the Arab world and the environment around us. I'm asking you, today you're not in office, official in the government of Israel for quite some time. If you were today one of the decision makers, what would be your recommendation to the policy in the interim range and the long range. Well, I'll just say a few words following what was said just now, and all the speakers will forgive me, but I think that you're just living in La La Land. Abu Mazen, Mahmoud Abbas, is not able to close a deal with us, is not able to implement an agreement had he closed it, is not able to survive after such an agreement. It's just not realistic. So it's very interesting academically to discuss to what conditions you could have reached an agreement with him and what concessions Israel would have made. But on the other side, there's no side that can come to any agreement with you or to implement it. And no less important to survive such an agreement. What's going to happen there on the other side? Let's say there would be an agreement and it would come out. You don't need to be to such an imagination to think what would happen. So under these conditions, what I'll get to that as well. I just wanted, I don't think the great excess to bring you back to earth, all of you, to reality, and not to live in some sort of a fantasy of that if they would give concessions here and there, then we would have an agreement tomorrow morning. There's no such possibility to reach such an agreement. Therefore, what we have to do beyond everything that we have to do in order to ensure our security, the security of Israel, the safety of the citizens, we have to do whatever possible in order to improve the conditions of the Palestinian population. First of all, in East Jerusalem. If we go from the easy to the difficult, the East Jerusalem, according to Israeli law, is part of the State of Israel. The Palestinians, the residents of Jerusalem, East Jerusalem, 300,000 people, most of them have Israeli IDs. They all have an option to become citizens. And nobody even thinks that we're going to negate this possibility from them. And the number that does it is not large, but it's growing. And if we do what we should have done years ago, to invest in the infrastructures of East Jerusalem and actually to make it a united city, where the Palestinians who live in East Jerusalem, who are part and parcel of the economic life of Jerusalem, you know, if you take a taxi in Jerusalem, half of the drivers are Palestinians from the East Jerusalem. The bus drivers are from Jerusalem. In hospitals, in Hadassah Hospital or in Mount Scopus, the doctors are Palestinians. And definitely the patients are Palestinians. So they're part and parcel of the economic life, but they're not part of the social life of Jerusalem because they live miserable conditions. It's a shame for the State of Israel that for all these years, we're talking 42 years, that we were not ready to invest in order to rehabilitate the housing there, to become normal housing. And I think that some of the motivations of those civil servants derive from the fact that people they work during the day in West Jerusalem, and they're in touch with the very affluent neighborhoods in Jerusalem, and then they have to go back to these awful conditions in which they live. And that, of course, raises the frustration and anger, and we see the phenomena. So what should we do in Jerusalem? There's a lot to do. I think there's a possibility to reach great achievements if we'll be ready to do it. In Judea and Samaria, it's more difficult, but there as well, there's more to do in order to improve the conditions, life conditions, and to raise the level of life. And I suppose that there's a correlation between the anger and the frustration and the hostility and the willing to murder Jews and the conditions under which the Palestinians live in Judea and Samaria. It doesn't console them if we say that their situation is better than those who live in Syria and Iraq. It doesn't, because they see how we live, how you can live, and therefore we have to start to bridge this gap. That's what we can do in the meantime. There's a paradox here of sorts. As for the security issues, we said that the relations with Jordan are very good, but the Jordanians don't want to be a partner and to represent the Palestinians. The relationship today with the Egyptians are good, but the Egyptians don't want to take upon themselves Gaza. They don't want to represent the Palestinians. And also from a security point of view, the relationship with Abu Mazen are good. To a great extent, Abu Mazen today survives because of the relations, the security relations he has with Israel. So all these paradoxes together, if you go back to reality and you see what can be done, it's really only in the human aspect, the people, to raise and to improve their level of life, quality of life. אני אמרתי, עם כל הכבוד, אולי לא הבינו אותי, אני אמרתי, זה לא שאם הכל או לא כלום, אני גם שמעתי מיוסי, ואני גם מאמין שעניין הביטחון הוא הבעייתי ביותר. ואני אמרתי, אני לא יודע אם אנחנו יכולים לפתור את כל הבעיות בבת אחת, מפני שמה שאתה אומר על ביטחון זה דבר חשוב מאוד, אבל נראה לי שאמריקה לא מובנת, ואני ביקרתי ב-110 קמפוסים באוניברסיטת בארצות הברית כדי לדבר על BDS ועל כל הבעיות, אבל לעניות דעתי יש דברים שישראל יכולה לעשות שאין לזה שום קשר לביטחון, וזה החלק בארצות הברית שלא מובן. אתה מדבר על כלכלה ואתה צודק ב-100% מבחינת העניינים הכלכליים, אבל באמריקה אנשים לא מבינים אם אתה אומר שאתה לא תתנחל במקומות שלא מעבר לגבול, ואמריקאים לא רואים איך הדבר הזה יכול בכלל לפגוע בביטחון הישראלי. יש שם שבק ויש שם שינבט ויש שם צהל. אבל אני מסכים איתך לגבי אבו מאזן, אבל אתה ודאי גם תסכים שאנחנו נמצאים בתקופת מעבר מאוד קריטית. עניתי ברמאללה 3 פעמים השבוע, והמעבר, זה ברור שהוא בפרק האחרון שלו, ואנשים מדברים על הדבר בצורה יותר פתוחה. והשאלה היא, כאשר האדם הזה, אבו מאזן, יעזוב את הבמה, האם המורשת תהיה, ונלחמים כמובן מי ירש אותו, אבל האם ימשיכו לדבר על במוסכים של אי-אלימות? אנשים יגידו, אנחנו ניסינו וזה לא הצלחנו. אני יכול למנות לכם את כל הטעויות שנעשו גם בצד הפלסטיני וגם בצד הישראלי, אבל העניין הוא שאני חושב שהיום העיתוי המאוד קריטי הזה, לנו יש אינטרס שהמורשת של אי-אלימות לא תשכח, לא תידחק הצידה. אלה הם דברים שאתה יכול לעשות בלי קשר לביטחון. אולי ביטחון זה העניין האחרון שיקח הרבה זמן, מפני שהיום המזרח התיכון הוא באמת מאוד לא יציב. לכן אני חושב שאנחנו צריכים להימלט מן המלכודת ולומר, אם אתה לא יכול לעשות הכל, אז אל תעשה כלום. זה לדעתי מלכודת שישראל צריכה לא ליפול לתוכה, משישראל תמיד חכמה, היא תמיד ידעה איך ליצור דברים כמו הרצוג, ז'בוטינסקי, בן גוריון. אנשים הבינו שאנחנו כישראלים, אנחנו רוצים את היחסים הנכונים ולעשות ככל הניתן. אפילו אם אי אפשר לעשות את הכל, אני חושב שיש דרך לברוח מהמלכודת הזאת של הכל או לא כלום. וחזרה אלייך, היא באה לאור הקשיים האלה שאנחנו לא יכולים להתגבר עליהם עם החברה הפלסטינית. הדיכוטומיה הזאת בין החמאס לבין הרשות והחשש שהרשות עלולה להתמוטט במוקדם או במאוחר. מה את יכולה לראות מבחינת שיחות רציניות שבאמת יתחילו? אני חושבת שכולנו הגענו למסקנה שזו עיתות מצוקה כרגע, וגם המציאות היא באמת פסימית. המנהיגים היום נמצאים בנקודות חולשה בשל כל אותן הבעיות שדיברתם עליהן, וגם בגלל הדיכוטומיה בין החמאס לרשות, וגם אנחנו לא נהנים מהמינוף שהיה לנו בזמנו עם המדינות הערביות, מבשל העולם הערבי גם הוא משתנה סביבנו. אבל אני חושבת שאנחנו גם ראינו שניהול הסכסוך, כפי שעשתה זאת ישראל, כמדיניות, גם הוא לא פועל, לא עובד. זה לא עובד עבורנו וזה לא עובד עבור הישראלים. ואנחנו הופכים להיות קשיחים יותר, אנחנו נהיים כותביים יותר היום, יותר רדיקליים, וזו המציאות. והמציאות של מזרח ירושלים היא בדיוק כפי שאתה תיארת, זה אפילו יותר גרוע בכמה מקומות. אבל לטווח הקצר, כולל העניין של רווחת הפלסטינים, זה דבר שהוא מאוד קריטי. אבל אם אנחנו מדברים על הטווח הבינוני והטווח הרחוק, אם אנחנו לא ניכנס לדיונים מעמיקים וקונקרטיים עם מעורבות של ארצות הברית והקהילה הבינלאומית בצורה מאוד משמעותית, עם, 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 עם מסגרת מסודרת, עם התחלה וסוף, לסיים את הסכסוך מתוך ידיעה שזה ייקח הרבה מאוד זמן ליישם. אנחנו מבינים שיישום זה משהו אחד והשגת מסגרת או הסכם זה דבר אחר, אבל אנחנו חייבים את זה לעצמנו, כולנו כאחד. הייתה הרבה ביקורת על ערפאת בשעתו שהוא לא מסוגל למסור את הסחורה, שאי אפשר להגיע איתו לסיכומים וכן הלאה וכן הלאה. אבל חלק רואים את הדברים האלה בצורה הזאת ואחרים רואים את זה ככישלון. וכנ"ל נכון עם כל מנהיג פלסטיני. אני לא חושבת שאם אנחנו פשוט נתמקד רק על האופי או היכולת של מנהיג מסוים אחד בקרב הפלסטינים מבחינת עשיית הדברים. כמובן שאדם אחד לא יכול לעשות את זה לבד. השאלה איך אנחנו משיגים את הכלל כדי לשלול את איחוד הזה. אנחנו צריכים כמובן לגייס גם את הציבור הפלסטיני שהוא מאוד מתוסכל, הוא לא מאמין בחמאס, הוא לא מאמין במנהיגות אש"ף, אפילו מבחינת חיי היומיום, פשוט חיי הרווחה היומיומיים. אבל יש לך אוכלוסייה שהולכת וגדלה, 3.2 מיליון אנשים, רק מיליון ומשהו בעזה, זה הולך וגדל. ואם אנחנו יחד לא ניקח על עצמנו את האחריות ונמשיך ונאמר שהפלסטינים והמנהיגים לא מסוגלים, נכון, מבחינה מסוימת זה נכון, אבל צריך שתהיה איזושהי מסגרת אשר תאפשר לנו לצעוד קדימה, שאם לא כן אני לא רואה את ניהול הסכסוך הזה שיימשך לטווח ארוך. אני לא חושבת שאפילו שיפור רווחתם של האוכלוסיות והתמקדות רק על הדבר הזה מבלי שבמקביל ללכת גם על איזה דיון מעמיק יותר, שיחות, איך שתרצו לקרוא לזה, בצורה קונקרטית. אני חושבת שהנשיא עבר דה-לגיטימציה מפני שהוא לא מסוגל באמת לעשות משהו לגבי הסכם השלום. ולכן היורש, מי שלא יהיה, לא יוכל לעבוד גם הוא. יוסי.
We are told for 24 years you've been negotiating since the Madrid conference and until today, and all the stations we mentioned on the way, we withdrew from Gaza, there's no citizen or Israeli soldier, we gave them everything, and what did we get? We got missiles, we got terror of knivings, and we got suicide bombers. What else can we do in order to overcome this sense that we really tried everything already and nothing is happening? So why try again? Well, the question is, what do we want to achieve? If what we want to achieve is maximum security no matter what, then I can understand the arguments. If our goal is to ensure that Israel is a Jewish and democratic state, then the real effort of the leaders, Zionists from left and right until today, who didn't accept Misha Arendt's thesis, whether it be Sharon or Netanyahu, and they talk specifically about this two-state solution because of the democratic issue. These people led, Sharon actually led to unilateral withdrawal in Gaza, and in my opinion, if Bibi Netanyahu today is the PM and in the next few years, he's going to do the same in the West Bank. He spoke about it in Washington when he came back and Bennett hit him on his head. And he said, no, I actually meant in the unilateral battle against terror, because until then we thought that we work very nicely with the terrorists bilaterally, and he's doing it unilaterally. This was his explanation. And of course, we recorded it in a very serious way. But what is he actually saying? He's saying, dear friends, I don't have a partner. Abu Mazen is the chick without wings, or with the feathers, or without feathers. I'm going to do everything myself. I'm going to determine the border, and I have a border. The head of the Likud before me already built it, not Yossi Beilin. So the Likud, he built that fence or the wall. He has no problem. He's going to go back there. It's less than 8% of the territory. Dear friends, it's there. It's over there already. And I'm saying, before you do that, because what Misha is saying will bring us to that. They'll bring us to that, unless they go for anything else, and there'll be no agreement. They'll say, we have no partner. Arafat wasn't a partner because he didn't shave, and Abu Mazen is not a partner because he's weak. And it's not exactly, I can't really make a joke out of it altogether. I mean, we do have a dispute with the Palestinian partner. How lucky that the Israeli partner is 100%. He wants peace. He wants agreement. He wants compromises. Oh, and a guy there with a suit and a tie is standing. He speaks English. He speaks against terror, and he says, I'll never go back to Pshat. This is a partner. I mean, really, this is not a partner for us. Okay, then I understand. We don't have a partner. So what are we going to do? If we don't have a Jewish majority already, I'm telling you, we don't have a Jewish majority anymore. The majority we have is a majority that is the Jewish cluster in the western side of Israel, and more than 400,000 people that came because of the law of return, and they're not Jewish by halakha. That's what's happening today. This is about, so, 51-49. Apart from Yoram Ettinger that does a different calculation. But if this is the situation, then a Zionist prime minister, and Bibi is so, I don't know, in 2 or 3 years, he's going to come and he's going to surprise everybody. He'll take Herzog for it because he can't do it alone, but he can do it together with Herzog. And he'll say to Herzog, what just as he said to me, I was the head of Meretz at the time, and I held his coalition before we withdrew from Gaza, although I wasn't enthusiastic of leaving Gaza, but I didn't want it. He's going to come to Bougie and he says, look, forget the fees and the arrangements. I'm unilaterally leaving the West Bank, and I said, are you coming with me or not? He'll say yes, as I will say yes. I don't like it, but I prefer that than staying there. That's why I'm saying, before you get to that point, because this is not a solution, it's not a solution. And again, people will say, so what did we do? We left the West Bank and they continued to shoot, and they will continue to shoot. I'm saying, get to an agreement, even if it's not perfect, it's better than not having an agreement at all. It's not the opposite. What Netanyahu said about the agreement with Iran was not correct. There will be a very non-perfect agreement, but it's better than not having an agreement at all. And this agreement can be signed with Abu Mazen to ensure a priori the implementation of the Arab initiative, that the Arab and Islamic countries will have embassies in Jerusalem after it will be divided. And then even if Abu Mazen himself is weak, the entire world accepts him and his signature as a legitimate thing. You see, and we have to end. I'm sorry, he says time is over. We were, and we were left as two states solution, as the preferred solution and the desired one to Israel, definitely to the Palestinians. I want to thank all our guests on the podium, and to you, the public, thank you very much.